morning and welcome to the online service of Jesus and Jean's Worship at the Cottage. We're still in quarantine down here in Gainesville. To keep Gainesville in your prayers, because it's really turned into a hot spot. They had, I think, like 212 new cases of COVID-19 yesterday, and so the hospitals are probably getting pretty full, so just keep them in your prayers. We want to welcome you here today, wherever you are, and we just thank God that we're able to stream live, and we go literally around the world, and so wherever you are, we pray that you're safe and that you're healthy, and we want to just offer each one of you a very heartfelt thanks for joining us each week. We're gonna do a little different type of praise and worship today. This is everywhere I perform, I always close out with a medley of what I call just old gospel songs, and they're just great songs and great songs of the faith. And so I'm gonna do a shortened version of that this morning, and then we're going to get in our message today. I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, dear Lord, shall be the way. Oh, sister, let's go down, let's go down, come on now. Brother, let's go down, down in the river to pray. Will the circle be unbroken by five or by five? Circle be unbroken by five or by and by. There's a better all the way down in the sky, Lord, in the sky. Some glad morning when the stop's over.
Shine.
Hide it under a bushel. Go!
I won't let it shine. Now my moment shine.
Will the circle be unbroken?
In the sky, Lord, in the sky, today. I talked with my youngest brother, Keith, this past week, and we wanted to remember our oldest brother, Wayne, who goes through kidney dialysis on a daily basis, and his kidney doctors have, you know, isolated him for sure at home, and so want to pray for him and Karen, his wife, and their family as they kind of work through his health issues. And then there was a high school coach that was for my younger brother Keith. His name is Lon Joyce, and he has ALS, has Lou Gehrig's disease, and so I want to keep him in your prayers. And then we have an unspoken prayer request for a friend of ours who just going through some difficult times, and next week, especially next Wednesday, is a going to be a very powerful day, and so I just want to keep him in the prayers. And then one thing I want you all to be praying about is that next Sunday we're going to go back to the cottage, and we're going to open up for Mother's Day and have a Mother's Day worship service at the cottage. So one thing we want everybody that is healthy, that can come and is doing well, but we certainly want to invite you to come and be with us. Just one thing to keep in mind is that we may be doing some of it outside. We're still working through the details about this to have a safe opening, reopening, and so that's going to be next Sunday morning at 10:30. We're going to go ahead and start, and then we had a report this morning from our friend Jeannie I. Puddington about her in-laws. If you may remember, we prayed for her mother-in-law, who was 91 years old, came through, tested positive for coronavirus, was put in the hospital, oxygen levels around 60, and this lady has come back. They've been able to put her in a rehab facility, I think down in Roswell, and her husband, I believe his name is Dave, tested negative for it, and so we give God praise for that. But they still have some hurdles to go through. Jeannie's mother-in-law, Jean, has not walked in over a month, and so they're having to make some decisions on how they're going to move forward with that process. So I want to keep them continually in our prayers as we go forward. That's amazing at 91 to be able to come out of that and come back from that. Praise God. And then we have another close friend of ours whose wife is undergoing cancer treatment, and they're I think out at MD Anderson out in Texas, and just a lot of difficulties with the COVID-19 present there, and there's a lot of details that they're trying to work through, and so want to keep them in our prayers as well. Just a little side note, next week I'm having a little minor surgery's on you, major surgery's on me, but I've got to be put to sleep and going through some oral surgery, and so if you can just kind of lift up a prayer for me, that'll be next week, next Wednesday as well. So let's pray. Let's go to the Father. Lord, we thank you for a beautiful, beautiful day. What a beautiful morning that we have here. It's amazing even to imagine that we're facing this global pandemic on such a beautiful and glorious day. God, it's just a true testimony of your power and your majesty and the fact that you are at work behind the scenes. You give us just a beautiful day where we can get out and enjoy nature, get out and enjoy the outside. Give us things to do to free us up from being in the house, quarantined, and all of those dynamics that we've been dealing with over the last couple of months. Father, we lift up each one of these prayer requests to you today and just pray that once again you would intervene in the way that only you can. God, all we can do is come together as the body of Christ and lift these prayer requests up to you. We continue to pray. I was even reminded again of our brother and sister, Bonnie and Howard, Howard's son, Mark, as he's still dealing with an infection in the spine. And God, I just pray your hand of healing on Mark and for Howard and Bonnie, that you would allow the peace of Christ to rule in their heart. God, we love you, and we thank you so much for loving us. We thank you for each and every single day that you give us. We don't take them for granted, God, especially during these times. We pray your blessing on our message today. Come, Holy Spirit, invade our hearts wherever we are in this country, wherever we are located, whatever we're dealing with. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us up on the end from and change us from the inside out. We love you, Lord. We pray your blessings today in the most powerful name, the name of your Son, Jesus. And all God's children said,
amen.
Amen. Well, this morning, we're going to be in the book of James. So if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to turn to the book of James. Or if you got an app on your phone, go there. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 12. And the title of today's message is Turning Our Trials into Triumphs. Turning Our Trials into Triumphs. Everybody ready to do that? Man, I hope so. I know we are. One thing I was thinking about this past week, is that as we prepare to open up our state and our nation, my opinion, I believe that we as the people of Christ have an obligation to our community and to the world, really, to show ourselves to be people of faith and not fear. You've heard me say that before. Faith, not fear. We are to be people of prayer, not panic. We build our strength through service. And so we have an opportunity as we move forward to pour the love of Jesus into the lives of many, many people, our friends, our family members, people we know outside of our circle. And a lot of those people are fearful. A lot of them are paranoid. They're anxious. And they're anxious about opening up our state and our nation, whether it's too soon. And the reality is that life as we once lived it is going to change and is going to see many different changes. What they will be, we're not really sure. We're still working through that. But one thing I do know is that we as the people of God are called to worship and to proclaim to the world the one who never changes. The Bible says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the only one that can take a mess and change it into a message. He's the only one that can take a test and change it into a testimony. And he's the only one who can take the trials that we face and turn them into triumph. And so, I want us to get going in this teaching. If you're ready, amen. If you're ready, we're going to jump right into it. First, I want to give you a little background on James. James was the half-brother of Jesus. He grew up with Jesus. However, throughout the ministry of Jesus, even up to the crucifixion, James didn't believe that Jesus was God. In fact, James, along with his brothers and sisters, even tried to have Jesus institutionalized one time. I told you before, I have three brothers. It's like me going to my three brothers and going, hey, I'm the Messiah, I'm the Son of God. And even though James saw all the miracles, he saw all the healings, he saw all the, heard all the teachings, witnessed everything that Jesus did, James did not believe that Jesus truly was God. And yet, he later became one of the key leaders, key figures in the early church. And to James, this is where he arrived. This is what he grew to. To James, real faith is not just something that we talk about. It's not something that I just teach about. It's something we do every day. Real faith is not just something that we discuss. Well, you got to have faith. Yeah. Faith of a mustard seed. Yeah. It's not just something we discuss. It really is who we are as believers. Real faith is to look at ourselves. It's at our reflection in the mirror of God's Word. And then it's our obligation to align our lives with that image. That as we see ourselves and see our reflection in the mirror of God's Word, and God's Word is the manual for life. It lays out all the things that we are and that we should be and that we should strive for. And as we look at our reflection in the mirror of God's Word, we're then to align our lives with that image. And remember that real faith is both powerful and desirable. It's actually infectious when you get around other people. Because real faith moves mountains. Real faith brings about salvation. It unleashes the power and promises of God. It overthrows kingdoms. It quenches the fiery darts of the enemy. It parts seas. It slays giants. It brings walls tumbling down. And having it, the Bible says, having it is the only way that we please God. James is a book about making our faith real. And over the next couple of weeks, I'm going to be looking at some messages in this great book. It's not a long book in the New Testament at all, but it's a very powerful book because of what James went through himself. And we know that as James came to know, we know as he came to know, that real faith is grounded in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And living it out in our lives results in a new life. It gives us a new purpose and a new identity. And we began to realize that we truly are servants of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning, as we unpack James 1, 1 through 12, we're going to be looking at it from the Message translation. We're going to see that real faith perseveres. That it really does turn our trials into triumphs. Listen as I read from the Message translation. It says this: I, James, am a slave of God. Isn't that powerful? James come a long way. I, James, am a slave of God and the Master Jesus, writing to the 12 tribes scattered to kingdom come. Hello. Consider it a sheer gift, friends, when tests and challenges come at you from all sides. You know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. You hear that? So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. And he says, if you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. You'll get his help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. Ask boldly, believingly, without a second thought. People, and I want you to listen to this, people who worry their prayers, oh God, oh Lord, people who worry their prayers are like wind-whipped waves. Don't think you're going to get anything from the Master that way. Adrift at sea, keeping all your options open. When down and outers get a break, cheer. And when the arrogant rich are brought down to size, cheer. Prosperity is as short-lived as a wildflower, so don't ever count on it. You know that as soon as the sun rises, pouring down its scorching heat, the flower withers, its petals wilt, and before you know it, that beautiful face is a barren stem. Well, that's the picture of the prosperous life. At the very moment everyone is looking on in admiration, look at me. At the very moment everyone is looking on in admiration, it fades away to nothing. Now listen to verse 12. Anyone who meets a testing challenge head on and manages to stick it out is mighty fortunate. For such persons, loyally in love with God, the reward is life and more life. Isn't that powerful? This past week, I read a true story. This is actually a true story about a family who had a pet ferret named Sprite. And one day, Sprite was having a pretty good day. He was just running around the house, kind of goofing off, and he started playing in a pile of clothes in the laundry room. But suddenly, things got bad. I mean, really bad, real fast. Within a split second, Sprite's world changed in a dramatic way. I mean, one minute he's jumping around in the laundry, and the next he had become part of the laundry. For you see, Sprite's owner didn't realize that Sprite was hidden deep within the pile of clothes when she picked the pile up off the floor. Guess that he had fallen asleep. We don't know what happened, how he got there. But whether he was awake or not, Sprite was tossed into the washer, the lid was shut, and then the water was turned on. Now, can you imagine what must have been going through this little guy's mind, little Sprite's mind, as the water began pouring in? The drum fills up with water. We don't know if it's hot or cold. And then suddenly the agitation cycle begins. And I got a picture of this little guy trying to balance himself or hold on to the top of the agitator with dear life. And you thought you were having a bad day. And then suddenly the churning stopped and the water began to drain out.
Oh no, it's been so.
The Sprite released his death grip on the agitator and he jumped down onto the damp clothes thinking, thank God this is finally over.
Not so fast.
But then the rinse cycle begins. And just when little Sprite thought that the worst was over, here comes the spin cycle. I can just see this little guy plastered against the side of the washer and as it spun around 800 to 1600 RPMs. Man, that had to be rough.
Six Flags.
Well, 24 hours later, the owner finally found the damp, shivering, still shell-shocked little critter still inside the washing machine. But the blessing was that at least he was found before he was tossed into the clothes dryer. The owner said Sprite doesn't play in piles of clothes anymore. That he actually goes into a massive panic attack whenever they turn on the washing machine. And really, who could blame him, right? Poor little guy. I mean, he never saw it coming. So my question for you this morning is, can you relate to Sprite? I think most of us can. You know, 1 minute you're standing in familiar territory, you're playing in a pile of clothes, you're happy, things are going great. And then the next year, you're tossed into life's washer. And the lid is slammed shut and the water turned on and you find yourself trapped in a damp place of spinning darkness. Your employer hands you a pink slip and tells you that they have to let you go. Your spouse tells you they don't love you anymore. They want a divorce. A police officer knocks on your door and tells you that they have your son or daughter downtown. The phone rings and you hear the words, there's been an accident. Your mother calls and tells you that you better get home as quick as you can. Your dad's just had a heart attack. The doctor looks at you from the tests that have been taken, the test results, and he says, it's terminal. There's nothing we can do for you. I mean, you didn't even see it coming, but in the blink of an eye, you find yourself being sucked into the dark caverns of despair as you're just swiftly tossed into the icy waters of an unwanted reality. The lid is shut. The churning begins as your world starts to spin hopelessly out of control. In our scripture that I read this morning, one of the things that I want you to understand is that the people who first held and read James' letter in their hands, they knew exactly what Sprite was feeling. Things in Jerusalem were going rather well for the church there. Tens of thousands had come to know the Lord, and more, the Bible says, were being added daily. They were, according to Acts chapter 2, enjoying the favor of God and of most people. And they were experiencing a fellowship, a oneness, a community, a sense of community that was almost beyond belief. In Acts chapter 4, it says this. It says, all the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all. Listen to this. God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them. They brought the money from the sales and they put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone who had need. Now, are you kidding me? I mean, can you imagine a church of 18 to 20,000 people spread throughout the city of Jerusalem and not one needy person among them. And no one claimed that any of their possessions were their own. And for the most part, life was just a romp and a pile of clothes. They were having a great time. And then in Acts chapter 8, things changed. Then came the stoning of Stephen. And on that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. And all except the apostles were scattered. They were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world. And a man named Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. And so the believers were suddenly scattered, as the Message translation said that I just read, to kingdom come. And so it was to this scattered, persecuted, dragged off, imprisoned group of believers, men and women who were weak and worn, they were tired and broken, beaten and persecuted, that James gives them this great truth, that real faith perseveres. That's a perfect place to begin, don't you think? And these words that were penned nearly 2,000 years ago, we find four keys or four truths that I believe that if we will embrace them, will empower us to turn our trials into triumphs. And it will help us develop a faith that perseveres. Now, these four truths that I want to talk about this morning are built on four words. First word is decide. The second word is develop. The third word is ask. And then the last word, the fourth word, is direct. And so I want to begin with the first word, decide. What is it that we need to decide? Well, in the book of James, it says that we must decide to have a joyful attitude. It's our choice that we have to choose to decide to have a joyful attitude. Verse 2 says, consider it a sheer gift, friends, when tests and challenges come at you from all sides. Now, there's three things about trials in these verses that I want to share with you. Number one, the first truth is that trials will come. God tells us in verse 2 that we should expect trials. And notice that he didn't say, if you have to face trials. But rather, whenever you face trials, whenever it comes, whenever you face trials, and though I, like you, would wish for it to be otherwise. But the truth is, trials, hardships, and difficulties are an unfortunate part of life. We all get our share. In fact, Jesus warned us in one of the disciples in John 16:33, shortly before his arrest, he said, in this world, you will have trouble. Paul in Acts 14:22 said, we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. You see, things will not always go our way. Amen? The road at times will get bumpy. But we must realize that trials will come. And therefore, we shouldn't be surprised by them. But instead, have an attitude of expectancy toward them. Now, I don't mean that we should run around like Chicken Little, you know, yelling at everybody, the sky is falling, the sky is falling. It's actually more of a military mindset. We live our lives with confidence grounded in the fact that we are prepared for conflict when it comes. Because here's the truth. When you know something is coming at you, you can be ready for it, can't you? When you know that strong waves are headed your way, you can plant your feet and you can stand firm. And so James says that trials will come and you can count on them. He also says that trials are varied. We all don't face the same trials. The NIV says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of various kinds. And so James tells us that not all the trials that we face are the same. They come in many different shapes and sizes and intensities and durations. And the trials of various kinds, he says. And so, does James talk about difficult marriages? Yep. Yep, that'd be in the category of various. Is he talking about being sick? Something like COVID-19 that we're facing right now? Yep, it's in there. Having financial problems, maybe relational conflict, trouble with one or more of your children. It's like Prego spaghetti sauce. It's in there. What if you're enduring a trial right now? It's in that term, various trials. Now, for most of us this morning, this talk of trials and hardships is not hypothetical. Because most of us, certainly Jan and I and everybody we've talked to, most of us are in the thick of things right now, and it's painful. You're tired, you're exhausted, you're weary, and perhaps maybe you joined us today hoping to hear a few words that would empower you to fight another round. In fact, as long as I'm being honest and chipper, it's not just the day of trial, it's the days, plural, it's the days of trial. And it's not just one and done. It's not, man, I'm so glad I got that one behind me, you know. No, it's mountain highs and it's valleys low. That's one of the things that I love most about the Bible. The Bible meets us in the world that we're living in right now. And it's not a fantasy. As we've learned over the last couple of months, our world is not sterile. It's grinding. People get sick. They die. They are betrayed. They are wrongly accused. They grow weary. They lose heart. On the other hand, some, by the grace of God, endure. Their legs are strengthened. Their heart is inflamed with passion. They hold fast and have a type of joy that transcends some of the most horrific circumstances imaginable. Why? How do they do it? Because in the midst of their trial, they made a decision. And that brings us to our next point about trials. Trials in our lives demand a decision. In 2 through 4 it says, consider it a sheer gift, friends, when tests and challenges come at you from all sides. Now, I want you to remember that James is writing to a group of people, most of who are impoverished, having been scattered and separated from their homes, many of their family members because of persecution. And James is encouraging them. He is saying to them, right in the middle of all this, and he says this, consider it pure joy. And so as I read this, I'm kind of scratching my head. So I'm saying, so is James saying that when a trial comes, that we're to just to put a smile on your face and just say that you love it, everything's fine, just fine. Oh man, it's great. Is that really what the Bible is actually telling us to do? Absolutely not. And I want you to understand this, because this is one of the most profound, most crucial truths necessary for mature Christian living. And listen to this. I mean, I want you to get this. This is not some emotionally flippant, fake, pseudo-happiness that we just kind of paint on our face when everything around us is just a total wreck. The word consider is a command. It's an imperative. Remember what I tell you about imperative statements. When you see a word like consider, put your name in front of it. Teddy, consider. It's a verb of thought. It means to count, to deem, to reckon, to think, to regard. It's about a mental decision, not an emotional response. Consider it pure joy. And pure joy indicates, the word pure indicates a sincere, genuine joy. And again, it's not something that we just paint on our face. Amen. God bless. Oh, yeah. Oh boy, I'm blessed and highly favored. Amen. Oh, glory. It's not that. It's not painted on. It's not plastic. It's not fake. And the first thing in order to turn our trials into triumphs is to make a conscious decision to put our trust in God and in His provisions for our future too. To make it a choice, a decision to have a joyful attitude. Now some of you people say, well, I am happy. Well, you need to tell your face. Because your face is not going along with what your mouth is saying. So that's not really having made a decision to have a joyful attitude. And granted, it's not our natural response. It's not. But one thing I found is that outlook often determines outcome. Now I want you to get that. Your outlook often determines your outcome. And for us to end with joy, you have to start with joy. And so in verse 2, God is telling us what to do. And then in the next 10 verses that we're going to cover, He's going to tell us how to accomplish this seemingly impossible task. So that's the first word, decide. The second word is develop. Very powerful word. And what we are to develop is that we are to develop the mind of Christ. 1 Corinthians 2:15 and 16 says this: the person with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, makes judgments about all things. But such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But listen to this last verse, very powerful. But we have the mind of Christ. If you're a believer and you've accepted Jesus, power of the Holy Spirit is living inside you, the Bible says that we have the mind of Christ already. But we have to develop it, don't we? Verse 3, it says, you know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. You go through a trial, it's going to show you exactly how much faith you really have. It's going to show your true colors. So it says, so don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Don't run like the seat of your pants are on fire. It says, let it do its work so that you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. You're going to come through the valley of the shadow of death, and you're going to come out the other side stronger, better prepared, well-developed, a mature Christian, not deficient in any way. So to overcome trials, to turn trials into triumphs, we must know, we must understand, and this knowing that James came to know, this knowing comes about by observation, and it comes by experience. Can't go around it, can't go under it, can't go over it. You got to go through it. And so I'd like to share three understandings that we can develop to turn our trials into triumphs. First, we need to develop, in developing a mind of Christ, we need to develop a mind that understands and that knows. That is the mind of Christ. Because just like Jesus faced a trial of faith in the Garden of Gethsemane, Father, if there's any way, there's any other way we can do this, God, let this cup pass from me. But not my will, but thine be done. And just as he faced a trial of faith in the Garden of Gethsemane, our faith will always be tested. And so we have to know whom we have believed. As Paul proclaimed in 2 Timothy 1:12, he says, that is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed and am confident. He's convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him. The Lord is able to guard what Paul had entrusted to him until that day. Same is true for you and I. Second, our God is always sovereign. You got a problem about something? You need to go to God and talk to him about it. Because our God is not only maker of heaven and earth, but he is ruler of heaven and earth. Every leader that's in place, every president, every governor, every senator, every representative, every person down to the head guy on the trash dump, is put in place by the sovereignty of God. You got a problem with the president? You need to talk to God about it. God put him there. You got a problem with your governor or your state representative, your senator? Go to God and say, God, let's talk about this. God is sovereign. He is the ruler of heaven and earth. And here's one main truth. Our trials, everything that we go through, everything that we face, are never, ever outside of God's control. The Bible tells us that we are loved with an everlasting love, and underneath are his everlasting arms. They're there to catch us, to lift us up, to stand us up straight, to lead us, guide us, come this way. He is a sovereign God. Third, every trial has a purpose. Every trial has a purpose. And it says so that we might be mature and complete and not lacking in anything. God's goal for our lives, for all of our lives, is to be complete and mature in him. To grow more and more into his likeness and knowledge of who he is. Now, here's the problem in our lives. The problem in most of our lives is that when it comes to trials, growth and maturity is not our goal. And let's be honest, most of the time, when you and I go through trials, our goal is just to get through it as quick as possible, right? Our goal is to fix the circumstances. Man, we do that the best. We need to fix the circumstances. We want to get things switched back to where they're supposed to be. in our minds. Back to the way that we had planned it and the way that fits best with our ideals and our ideas and our ideologies. But here's a reality check for you. God is more concerned about our character than he is our comfort. I want you to get that. God is more concerned about our character than our comfort. And trials really are joy, can be tremendous joy when God is our goal. And I want you to get that. Trials can be joy when God is our goal. When we believe that knowledge of God and intimacy with God is supremely satisfying, then the trials which cause us to trust, to lean on, to pursue God, can bring us joy. The third word is the word ask. Ask God for wisdom. It says, if you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. And you'll get this help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. You're not bothering God when you go to him and ask him for help. He's not going there, oh, here comes Teddy again. Oh, what are we going to do with this boy? Never. He's not going to be condescending to you. He's going to help you. Now, it's significant to note what James didn't say. He didn't say that if you lack wisdom in handling your trials, he didn't say, go study philosophy or go pick up the latest self-help book or go meditate, you know, or go get advice from someone that you think is wise, some guru. No, James didn't say any of that because the wisdom that each one of us needs, the wisdom that we must have to turn our trials into triumphs, is available only from God. Who are we to ask? God. The Greek actually says to ask the giving God. Now, isn't that a wonderful, wonderful description of our God? And the giving God will give us this wisdom without finding fault, without giving us a hard time for asking. And so not only are we to ask God for wisdom, but we're also to ask in faith. It says, ask boldly, believingly, without a second thought. People who worry their prayers. Oh God, oh Lord, help me. We're dying down here. Oh gosh, let me go read this book. Oh, now, it says people who worry their prayers are like wind-whipped waves. And it says don't think that you're going to get anything from the Master that way. You can go boldly before him. Because if you go that way, you're adrift at sea. You're putting your faith in too many other things, and you're keeping all of your options open instead of just going straight to God with the trials. And so asking in faith, we are to ask in faith, believing. That's what Jesus says. If you ask, ask believing that God is good. Believing that he is wise. Believing that he, the God of the universe, has offered to give us the wisdom, the knowledge, and the perspective to walk through this time that we're experiencing. The fourth word is direct. It says to direct your focus to your ultimate prize. Anyone who meets a testing challenge head on and manages to stick it out is mighty fortunate. For such persons loyally in love with God, the reward is life and more life. It's life here and now, and more importantly, it's life eternal. And we're reminded in our trials that this world is not our home. We're just passing through. We're just sojourners here. And we may live through these trials relatively unscathed for most of us. But the reality of our living is for our reward that's to come. This is how we can face the most devastating circumstances in the world, because we know that this world's not our home. And there's coming a day when God reveals himself and we shall be in totally completeness, not lacking anything, totally mature and complete. And we'll be glorified with him. And so I want to encourage you this morning, and I'm in no way trying to make this sound trite. I know there are trials present in all of our lives right now, but I want to encourage you not to waste your trials. I want to encourage you as you face these present trials to fix your eyes on the goal, who is God. Draw near to him. Rely on the resources that he provides. A.W. Tozer once said, he's a wonderful devotional writer and pastor, he says, "The widest thing in the universe is not space. It's the potential capacity of the human heart. Being made in the image of God, it is capable of almost unlimited extension in all directions. And one of the world's greatest tragedies is that we allow our hearts to shrink until there is room in them for little besides ourselves." That's a powerful statement. So this morning, I want to encourage you, decide to have a joyful attitude. Develop the mind of Christ that you already have. Ask God for wisdom and ask in faith. And then finally, direct your focus to your ultimate prize. Together, we will turn our trials into triumphs. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the power of your word. We thank you for the writings of James and the understanding that he came to. And I pray for each one of us, God, that we will come to that same understanding, that we will operate out of the power of the Holy Spirit alive in us, the mind of Christ that we already have, that we will do these things, access these keys, these truths that we've talked about this morning, and not just hear them, not just have the head knowledge, but we would apply them to our hearts and live out of that power each and every day. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. God love you. We'll see you next week at the cottage.
And all God's children said.
And all God's children said.
Amen.
Amen. God bless y'all.